something in the world-famous green and white hoop shirts with no numbers on their back, only on their white shorts. A clock to Murdoch. In comes Craig. Kimberly scored a great goal! He's done it! Murdoch.
Good morning and welcome to another episode of the Rhebel Podcast. Not coming to you from the balcony of freedom, nor from the couch of justice. We are coming to you from the office of socialism. My name is not Prefontaine, because I'm not a wanker. My name is Callum, and I'm joined by my father and okay friend, Frank.
Cheers, son.
Now, we're not joined by Prefontaine in the studio. We're joined by him on a thing called FaceTime. Prefontaine, how are you?
Very well, thank you, Callum. How are you going?
I'm good, mate. Where is...
Hello, Frank.
Hello, Pre.
Where's Prefontaine?
I am in the cultural epicentre of Boston. I'm in a Dunkin' Donuts. just off of Boston Common with my hot chocolate and ready to talk all things Celtic with you guys.
Why aren't you with a donut?
Because I'm going to go out for dinner and I just don't feel like having a donut right now. And I've eaten enough shit American food to last me a lifetime, so I don't need that extra donut just to chuck on a bit more fat that I've already developed over the course of the last 2 weeks.
Fair enough. So you decided a week ago, is it a week ago?
Yeah, I guess so, yeah, on Sunday, a week on Sunday.
Well, what did you decide? Tell the viewers.
I decided to go to watch the Red Sox win the World Series at Fenway Park. Fenway Park.
How'd that go for you?
It went well.
Good.
I was a little nervous after I bought my tickets on Sunday night.
For what? For Game 6 or Game 7?
If Game 6 would even happen, because the next day was the Game 4, and if St. Louis had won that game, then the next day when Game 5 was happening, which would have been an elimination game, I would have actually been flying to the States and I would have not known the score and would have landed and potentially the World Series would have been all over. So before I left, the Red Sox managed to win Game 4 in St. Louis, which was good to know because that meant there was definitely going to be a Game 6. And it all worked out well because they won. It was a good night.
As you text me, I think, a couple of hours before when you were thinking about going, you said, I've been to Seville, so why can't I go to this game? So you.
Well, that's right.
You literally flew out, or you booked your ticket on the Sunday and you flew out on the Monday.
Yeah, I flew out on the Tuesday and got there on the Tuesday and the game was on the Wednesday.
But more importantly, just overlooking that completely, why didn't you then go to Amsterdam?
I thought about that.
Not very long.
And I've done that before, but it's just too tiring. That extra flight across the Atlantic and then the whole then going from Glasgow to Europe thing for a Champions League game, it just knocks you out. And I just kind of thought, you know what, I'm just gonna watch it from good old Boston.
Nah.
Which was good. Which was good anyway. And I'm kind of, and after the result, I'm kind of fucking glad I didn't go because it looked like it was.
Well, we were hoping you would go after the result because then we knew we had someone to blame for the pathetic
result.
Believe
me, you know. I was worried about the whole... I was even worried about the Red Sox game, thinking that, you know, maybe when I do these big travel trips for sport after Seville, maybe I'm a jinx. This is just, you know, be bad news. So I'm glad to know that I'm not completely a jinx. So I'm glad you go to Amsterdam for that.
And in the end, it was a lot safer for you not to watch the game in Amsterdam.
Yeah, it was actually safer in Dorchester, which apparently is meant to be... Can be a bit dicey every now and then, but at 3:30 in the afternoon, it was all sound. It was all very good. Yeah, no, just reading on Twitter and all the articles and all the sort of YouTube postings and stuff. It was crazy.
Yeah. Well, we'll get to that in a minute. I guess what we can do is we can talk about the game first, and just have a quick debrief about that.
Can I just go on about, because I don't want him, he's getting away with that a bit too lightly.
Okay, yeah.
He could have taken a 7-hour flight for $530 bucks, or you could have taken the scenic route, 15 hours, with Air France, Boston, New York, Paris, Amsterdam, for $1,120 bucks.
Are you doing research right now, Frank, and telling me that's how much it would have cost?
I actually did it 5 minutes ago, yeah.
All right.
And I was interrupted because I started researching the Santa Maria and the Santa Nina and the Santa Pinta, which, by the way, Santa Pinta, getting off that subject, is Spanish for excessive paint job. How's that? For a link, celticdecor.com.au.
New website.
I watched the game with the Boston number one CC, and I said I'd give a big shout out to the guys down at the Banshee in Dorchester. They put on a good spread. They got really cool facilities there. They got their own room upstairs in this pub, which is just decked out in all the Celtic paraphernalia and stuff. It's really cool.
Very good.
I mean, they're really good guys. And I walked out of there actually pretty pissed at like 7 o'clock that night, and I had to race to the Boston Garden to go watch the Celtics. And I walked up, you know, pretty hammered. When I was watching the game there, a whole bunch of painters rocked up, and I actually had to double check, make sure it wasn't you.
Yeah, that's one shout you wouldn't want to get into.
No.
Well, that's right. And I kind of thought, geez, I wonder if Celtic Decor would want to open up a Boston division and do a bit of painting. I'm sure there's plenty of work to be done. Apparently their economy is on the up, so there might be some work for you over here, Frank.
Oh, keep an eye out. I'll send you some cards. You can start passing them out.
Yeah. I'll do it on the street corner.
Yeah.
All right. So,
if you got the contract to paint Dunkin' Donuts, all the Dunkin' Donuts in Boston, you'd be millionaires. There's fucking heaps of them everywhere.
Really?
As you would say, Frank, they're like dog shit. And their coffee tastes like dog shit too.
It's a good job you don't drink coffee.
Mm.
How's the hot chocolate? Any better?
It's actually not a bad hot chocolate, actually.
That's good.
You wouldn't have wasted one of your coffees over there, would you?
Well, I have had a few coffees, and I'm debating whether or not I add that to my list.
No, you can't count them.
Because it's just basically coffee-flavoured milk.
Yeah.
Why can't they do a good coffee?
I don't know. And they have it in big, like, big tubs. So it's even weaker.
Did Boston have a mayor race as well? Or was it just...
They did. There was an election on Tuesday. Right. And they...
did you hand out how to vote cards?
No, I didn't. Okay. The current incumbent... Mayor Menino has not recontested, and it was won by another guy. Two Irish guys, Americans, were running, and so it was all very interesting.
Very good. All right, well, we've talked about 10 minutes worth of nothing there, so that's good. Let's go on to the Ajax game. So put your hand up if you watched the Ajax game. Now, for those without video or ability to watch this podcast live, that was me and Prefontaine who put our hands up. Dad, where were you?
Yes, I was on my bike.
On his bike. So you're giving shit to Prefontaine for not turning up to watch it live.
I had a premonition it was going to be a bad...
Yeah, a premonition, right.
Yep. Plus, I've missed every other of my early morning sessions. By the way, it's 5 o'clock in the morning to watch the Celtic. And I actually could have got back home in time to watch the game.
In the end.
But thank God I didn't, because Callum was filling me in with how the game was going, which didn't sound too good.
So, Pre, do you want to kind of run through your thoughts of the game?
In terms of the team selection, I didn't really have too much of an issue with that. I kind of would have rathered Ledley instead of...
Why didn't Ledley start?
I'm assuming this wasn't 100% fit.
Right, that's...
So I was happy with the team selection. But
what about the way they lined up, Pre?
Well, it was kind of hard to work... When they, you know, like they put up the list of where they're going to play, that's not where they played.
No.
The game. I don't know what was going on in the midfield, but I just felt that Ajax were cutting through us like butter through butter.
Like what?
You'll get that one right in a minute.
Yeah, no, I completely. I'm tired. Yeah. Because they literally were just running right through the centre of the park. And I don't know what, and it seemed like we're either a yard off the pace or we were trying to do some sort of zonal defending, but it wasn't working because they were kind of, you know, when you play drafts or checkers and you just go, you tic tac through and
yeah.
take people's checks off the table. That's the way they were passing. They're just like, you know, 1, 2, 3 all the way throughout at midfield, and it was just shit.
Yeah. Apparently, Charlie had one of his worst games.
Yeah, no, he didn't have a great game. None of the midfielders had a good game.
Mm.
I don't think Jamie Forrest got his first touch until like
the second half.
15 minute mark was that? It was just ridiculous.
It was in terms of the shape, it was the lineup. It was the strongest, I guess, team we could put out other than putting Ledley in there. And we didn't touch the ball for the first 10 minutes. Like, didn't actually touch it. And then it went from we touched the ball to then as we would have the ball and wouldn't. I don't think we actually strung together two passes in the first half. So when that happens, you know you're going to be in for a bit of a long day. The thing about it was
I was going to say the other indication was that Izzy actually had a pretty good game and was one of our better players. You know things are going bad when Izzy's going to have a good game and everyone else is stinking it up.
Yeah. The first half we were so lucky to come in. I mean, not that they really created anything, but we were very, very lucky to come in nil all. And you thought, well, the team might do okay here. The problem is when you go from not trying or, like, you know, 5% to then trying to play at, you know, 80 or 90%, it's going to take you a few minutes to get into it. And the problem is they spent a whole 45 minutes not getting into the game. Ajax come out second half and score almost, you know, straight away with a superb goal it was in the end.
Yeah.
And then you're really, back up against the wall. Ajax, you know, it was a big stadium. They were making noise for the whole 90 minutes. Our midfield could not control the ball or get into the game at all. I don't think Stokes had a touch for the entire game. He had one shot on goal, which was shit. You had, you know, really, the only person that was actually trying in the end of the game was Kyle, and he got subbed for Ledley.
Mm.
You would have thought Mulgrew would have been that guy to change. And you just look at Neil Lennon, you know, he's selected the players. Up until that point, he can't do anything, you know, he's simply managing the team, he can't do anything. You know, the players on the field, but why does he time and time again not use his substitutions? He uses the substitutions with 10 minutes to go. I don't see the point of putting Ledley in with 15 minutes to go or, you know, Pukki with 5 minutes to go. What is that going to achieve, if anything? At one point, we were playing with no out-and-out strikers on the actual game. And he continued to let Chris Commons play when Chris Commons was clearly not fit. So, yeah, what is... I mean,
Commons was in and out of the game.
And you have...
He had one of his old traditional kind of...
Oh, Sammy was horrible.
Just hung onto the ball too much, and they kept on losing possession.
And the fact that Izzy was on the same size as Sammy shows how well Izzy actually played, because Izzy was playing against two players, two guys down that wing, so it was incredibly hard for him. And Samaras would see that was a problem, and instead of being proactive about it, he would sit and wait at the halfway line, and then when the ball came over that side, and they were halfway down our pitch... He would then start running, and he didn't give Izzy enough time to do anything. You know, didn't give the defenders the time they needed to try and track back and help out. Because in the end, the defenders were the only players that actually played okay, or up to, you know, some type of standard. Thanks for that, Pre. Thanks for that show of support there.
Is he still there?
Hi.
What happened? Hold on.
Having a bit of a problem there, Pre, with...
Hey, Dunkin' Donuts, want me to buy another hot chocolate if they want me to get one using their Wi-Fi, so they cut me out. I can hear you again, though. Keep going.
Okay, there you go. I was just saying that, you know, the only players that actually played okay were the defenders. Other than that, it was a really...
Yeah, I thought the defence... I really couldn't have much fault at our defence. I just think the midfield really let us down. And I don't think it really... I don't know if it was just me... And I'd be interested to get your thoughts on this, your guys' thoughts on this. But the amount of times that when we played a back pass to Fraser, he would just lather the ball up the park into sort of, you know, 50-50 one-on-one situations in which, you know, 7 times out of 10 we'd lose possession and Ajax would then start from the back and come, you know, build again. When there were plenty of opportunities where he didn't need to do that. He could have just knocked it out wide to a, you know, left back or the right back and keep the ball on the deck. And it was this fucking long ball shit the whole time, which is just not how we normally play. And I don't know why we kept on doing that. Like, every time, by the end of the game, I was getting so angry every time they back passed it to Fraser, because he was just going to pump up the park and give the ball away and start again. I was just giving a shit.
He's, of all the reports that I did read, that was the general theme came through that, you know, one of the things that's letting him down in his performance is his disposal. And it's almost like he's aware of that, acutely aware of that. So rather than, you know, try to improve it, he's just going to play safe, you know, not make any mistakes, just clear it so, okay, his name is, you know, there's no black marks against him by, you know, as you say, just punting the ball at the park. And you're right, we, you know, when we're playing with Sammy as the target man, that also gives Fraser the get-out clause. You know, I'm under restriction, I've got to punt. But, you know, when we're playing with two guys who play wide left and right, there's no way that those guys aren't available, you know, on occasions where Fraser can, if he could pass the ball, give it to them.
Yeah.
I'm interested to hear what the reaction was while you were watching, because, you know, when you're in a strange place, and I noticed that a lot, like last time I was in New York watching a couple of games, you're acutely aware of other people around you, and because you're not in a comfortable place, you're sort of, you're half concentrating on the game, but you're also watching the other people's reaction and seeing if it's similar to what you're used to. How did you find watching the game?
It was funny, actually, because there was one particular bloke there who had a bellowing, deep baritone Glaswegian accent who would just yell at the top of his voice throughout the whole game. And at the start, it was kind of annoying, but then after a while, it just became quite funny because I would try and guess what he would say. I had a chat to him after the game, and he's a good man. But he was in the zone. He was like absolutely tuned into this game and was just like, oh. And being in America, you don't notice. We forget that Americans don't curse as much as the Scots or the Irish or even Australians do. So you only normally hear swear words, and hanging out with, you know, 25, 30 Glaswegian and Irish guys,
it all comes back quickly, doesn't it?
It all came back very, very quickly, including the C bomb on numerous occasions, and that was from the 15-year-olds. So our family had just moved over. Fucking cunt. You're exactly right. I found a lot of the time I was paying attention to the people around me, and I wasn't really saying much at all. I was just sort of in the corner there with my pint and just watching the game, and actually thinking to myself, 3:30 in the afternoon, this is when we should be watching bloody Champions League games, because...
Absolutely.
But they were saying to me, without getting off the topic too much, they were saying that, you know, those, when the Boston winter comes and you've got like a league game against Kilmarnock and it's at... 7 in the morning and it's like -5 out and there's snow everywhere, can you really be fucked driving down to the Banshee to go watch the game? So they have their own kind of, you know, we always complain in Australia about the shit times to watch games, like, you know, those 2 o'clock in the morning.
We generally walk around in shorts and t-shirts.
Yeah,
that's right. But they had their own kind of challenges as well, even though they're only sort of, you know, 5, 6 or 7 hours away. I was very acutely aware of my surroundings, and it was interesting.
And what about people sort of becoming aware that you're a sort of stranger?
I got one or two odd looks, and it was only towards the end someone came up to me and said, where are you from? And I said, I'm from Melbourne. They're going, Melbourne? Melbourne, Australia? Bloody hell, I've got a cousin in Sydney.
Do you know him?
You must.
Do you know him?
You must know him.
Once that happened, then that was it. They all started buying me drinks, and I kind of walked out of there pretty pissed. They were a good bunch of blokes. They're trying to get me to come down on Saturday morning, or tomorrow morning, actually, for the... who we got this weekend? Did D United or something?
No, Ross County.
I thought you'd definitely be going to Glasgow for the Ross County game.
Oh, wow.
It's an away game.
It's actually sold out, so you can't get
it. It's an away game.
That'll make you want to go now, won't it?
Yeah, that's right. Anything that I can't get into, I want to go to. Yeah.
Pre, were you nervous before the game? What did you think leading up to it?
No, I was actually kind of excited. I was excited about what did I do that day? I went down to Fenway and went to the team store and dropped a, you know, cool $6,000 or $7,000 on the merchandise in there. And then went out to lunch and then headed down to Dorchester for the game. So I was excited about meeting new people and seeing a game in another city, and didn't really think too much about the game itself. I kind of thought that that will take care of itself.
Yeah.
So I wasn't... No, I really wasn't nervous, actually.
Because, like, it was... as you were saying, kind of watching it... Normally, I mean, most games, me and Dad watch together, and then for the big Champions League games, you normally come over and it's a bit of an event. In terms of you come over, that's the event.
That is the event.
And so I was watching it. I decided to watch it on ESPN 3, the TV thing, which is bloody the best thing Fox has ever done.
Yeah.
But I decided to watch it in my bed because I couldn't bother getting up.
Yeah. So it wasn't on ESPN 1, 2 or SBS?
No, it was the Barca game was on every channel.
Right.
I would have thought World Movies was the best thing Fox ever did, but no.
The tradie channel.
Yes.
And so it was, I wasn't nervous at all because watching in your bed's like a whole different experience than watching it, getting up and watching it.
Now what are we talking about?
And so I wasn't nervous at all. And then when we started to play worse and worse and worse, that's when it started to whole, like that's when it started to get very, very annoying. And it just was, and it just became more annoying than anything because it was, like watching them not even be able to pass to each other. And you could hardly hear the fans, I think it was because they were probably drowned out by the Ajax fans and stuff, but the whole thing was just, it was like, just felt like everything was up against us. And it was,
Yeah. It certainly felt, in the first 10, 15 minutes, I thought, oh, here we go, we're going to have another one of these sort of bad away European experiences that are sometimes all too familiar. When I kind of thought that after last season that we kind of turned the corner on that. I just don't think the team gave themselves a good account. Or certain players in the team didn't give themselves a good account of themselves and, you know, I've paid the price because they're really up against it now if they want to progress into, not even the Champions League, but the bloody drop into the Europa League. It's going to be tough.
Who do you think actually got a pass mark for the game?
I thought the DFC played quite well.
Yep.
Lucy had moments. I thought he played okay. He fucking that howler. He should have scored.
Yeah.
We actually had some. You're not going to get a lot of chances away from home in the Champions League anyway. And the chances we did have, if it had fallen to a half decent striker, then it might have been a different story. Because that's what you do. You know, you snatch those. That's how you win away from home. It's a jammy. You don't normally go to other teams' stadiums and dictate play. It's a jammy win if you're going to win. You know. And we just didn't take advantage of the chances that we had because a lot of those guys had an off night. And yeah, I'm struggling to name two players that I thought were.
I would say the only players that I thought played okay was I thought Izzy had a decent game, and the two centre backs had a good game.
And the keeper, the back four.
I think Ambrose had his moments where he does that thing. If he cuts this out, he would be a bloody brilliant player. Like Van Dijk is excellent. He's a seriously good find. And that's why we obviously Neil Lennon wasn't worrying when we lost or when we sold Wilson at the start of the year. But Ambrose does his thing, and he does it in league games a lot. You know, it's like the Stephen McManus get Gary Caldwell. Well, he'll run into someone's space and then pass in the ball, or he'll run into the space. The space is now crowded out because you've held onto the ball for 5 seconds, and then he'll do the big long ball. Now he's not doing the long ball as much, but as you said, we kept playing that long ball either from the keeper or from the centre backs to Samaras, who did not win one header all game. That was probably the worst game he's ever seen. And
then they unlike Sammy.
Yeah, very unlike him. And he was the captain as well, so you thought, you know, maybe he's had an off night. But so you kept passing him, didn't win a header, and then they were changing over to Stokes, who I'm now totally off Stokes. I don't like him at all. He should be sold. But they kept trying to pass to him in the air. Now he's not the strongest in the air. Okay. But he wasn't even doing that attempted jump and trying to put the guy off. It was just, he was incredibly lazy. I felt sorry for him because he didn't touch the ball. It was, you know, a bit like James Forrest. You have to give them the ball for them to do something. They're not going to go and create something, you know. So
yeah.
I felt sorry for them in that regard. But I just think Stokes has had too many opportunities. He's had a couple of Champions League games now, and he's clearly shown he's not up to that standard. He's SBL standard, okay, but he's definitely not a replacement for Gary Hooper, who... In the end of the day, scored goals in Champions League. So, you know.
Yeah.
That's part of the board's fault and part of Neil Lennon's fault for not buying a proper striker.
So, Calum, under your theory, if Neil wasn't worried when he bought in DVD, because Wilson left. He must be sincerely shit himself now that he's sold Hooper and the guy he's replaced. Any one of those three guys that he's replaced are no good.
Yeah, well, that's absolutely. And he's obviously been... Neil's given a budget, and that's the constraints that Celtic Football Club has now, but he had a lot of money, or he should have had a lot of money to spend money on a decent striker, and the three players he's brought in, he hasn't either... You know, and there's some... Yeah, there's obviously been some injuries and things like that, but there's been no cohesion in the team selections from week to week, so he's chopped and changed. And he did have £5 million worth of... £5 million worth of players on the bench which he didn't use until, you know, the 75th minute. So that's part of his team selection as well. If you're not going to give these guys a go, what's the point? You know, we don't know what Tom Rogic is like, but if you're not going to give him a go tomorrow in the Ross County game when he's complained about the constraints of his size, when he's complained about the squad size and the fact that he doesn't have a ready squad, he's mentioned that almost every week. If he's not going to give guys like Tom Rogic a go, what's the point of having him there?
In a Premier League that doesn't have really any competition anyway, because Rangers don't exist anymore.
Correct.
When you can, and you can, you know, run, you can have a bit more freedom to play younger players like Tommy Rogic or Tony Watt, who's away on loan, or Jackson Irving, who's away on loan. You know,
that's the good thing about that. At least those guys are getting game time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's true. Look, I think the other thing I want to mention was that, I don't want Celtic to sign a big money striker. I'm happy for Celtic to continue to buy players that are from leagues that aren't as highly fancied, or names that we've never really heard of. And I think that, is it John Park, the guy that is chief scout? Between him and whoever else works in that department of the club, have done a pretty good job in the last two or three years of signing. It's very difficult to go out and actually try and, you know, sign quality players. And, you know, think about the Martin O'Neill era. There was just as many good signings that Martin got as there were stinkers. Whereas I think that under Lennon, the ratio of sort of, you know, wins and losses in that signing has been more in the favourable ledger than the less favourable. But maybe it's a bit early in the season, but clearly from indications so far that the guys that we have signed with the money that we got for Gary Hooper have not worked out. They've just, you know, I mean, Pookie has not impressed me. That Boa Constrictor, whatever his fucking name is. I know he's been injured, but he's not the kind of guy that's going to, you know, play on that last defender and pinch goals for you.
Are you talking about Dirk?
Yep.
Dirk Diggler.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, yeah, at least Pookie looks like a footballer. So does Dirk, looks pretty good too, but they're not those out-and-out poachers. Whereas Baldy, they've openly admitted that they've bought a player who's an unfinished product. For £1.5 million, pounds, I would have thought you would at least get someone who could trap the ball.
Yeah, I know.
The thing about... It's a fair point. I mean, I don't think anyone or any sane Celtic supporter is saying that you're going to buy a big money striker, because it hasn't really worked in the past. You know, talking about the previous, you know, or the last couple of years, when we brought in Keane on loan, that didn't really help us at all.
And that Welsh prick?
John Nartson probably is the last big money signing that we've done in terms of forwards. Because Craig Bellamy and Roy Keane were both on loan.
Yeah. So that's okay that, you know, we're bringing these players, but part of that as well is Neil Lennon not giving... Now, how do we know if Pookie played, or if how well Pookie would have played in that game, because he got 15 minutes. So, you know, my whole thing, which I said to Dad after the game, and was it's all fair and well to have guys like Samaras, who we know has competed and played well in Champions League games, or have guys like Stokes who are, you know, dependable during SPL games, or someone like Chris Commons, who has been playing excellent the last season. He's had a great season. But after 45 minutes of watching that, probably the worst 45 minutes of football I've ever seen, definitely this year we've seen Celtic play, what is the point of then giving these players an extra 30 minutes? If you're going to give them a shellacking, which I'm assuming Neil did at half-time, and they don't improve within 5 to 10 minutes, take them off. Samaras was not improving after 15 minutes, so why do you let him stay on there? Chris Commons was dead on his feet, you know, after 15 minutes after the interval, so why do you let them stay on there? You know, there's an argument for, oh, well, Chris Commons, you know, for the maybe chance of the free kick. Well, he had a couple of free kicks, and fucking not one of them beat the first man or the wall. Not one of our crosses beat the first man or the wall. You know, what are they... I just don't understand, when you're the manager, or, you know, the Gary Parker or Mowby, why aren't you pushing for someone to come on from the bench, someone like Joe Lely, someone like Piggy Early, and have the ability to change the game? Because they don't... Giving them 15 minutes is really not giving them a lot of time to do anything. Not many players in world football can do something in 15 minutes, especially someone that Sully can afford. That's what I would say.
I guess I'm only sort of guessing here, but I assume that Lennon kind of thought that things were going okay and that something might come out of leaving Samaras on. And because Sammy is that kind of player, he can have a nightmare on the north side and score, so...
I think it'll come back to the Gange. The 11 players he picked were the only ones who could stand up. The guys on the bench had had too much Gange.
I know, and they were really hungry roller counts as well.
Yeah.
So, do I put a line under that and just...
No one's mentioned the referee. Did he have a good game?
Yeah, he was fine. Honestly, he was
damn
okay. He probably could have booked one of them for diving maybe on early on.
Right.
But, fuck, he could have sent off Izzy quite easily.
Right.
Izzy hacked two guys, got a yellow card, then hacked two guys straight afterwards.
Right.
So there was maybe a dive on one of those ones.
I thought the referee was a bit card happy, but I wasn't.
He booked Samaras early for not a particularly rash challenge, but no. You can't definitely not blame the referee. He was, in terms of what you're going to get in European football, he was.
Where was he from?
Best. Some Eastern European country, I think.
He looked like an Italian version of Mr. Bean.
Right. So he wouldn't have been on the Gange then?
No, not at all.
Oh, damn it.
Yeah.
I tried to get Neil Lennon's thoughts after the game, but I can't find it anywhere. But he just said, which is what you said at the start, Pre, that a lot of players would have been disappointed in their result, in the way they played, and we've lost an opportunity. But if Barcelona, I'm paraphrasing here, if Barcelona beat Ajax in 2 weeks' time in the Dam and we beat Milan, it's, you know, turned around and we're back into it.
Yeah.
So
Milan next.
Milan at home. And then Barcelona away. The good thing about it is Barcelona's qualified, so if they beat Ajax, they will finish top of the group, so hopefully they leave a few players out, I guess.
It all sets up for one of those famous European nights at Parkhead.
It does.
There'll be,
it
from
does.
Start to go, we flat out just try and score.
There was a couple of people on Twitter saying things like that, and then a couple of other soccer supporters going, I don't know, there's two points of view there, and they were going, I don't want to keep... Like, I'm more than happy to do my part for the team on those European nights, but how about they give me something in return?
Yeah.
Which is an interesting point of view, because they, you know, we had two... We had cousin Sean, who's off to bloody Doha today. Good luck, Sean. And Jules, who went. Jules freaking got the bus all the way to Amsterdam. And it's a long couple of days. That's all I was saying.
Yeah, that's... I didn't realise they were doing that. That's nuts.
Well, Sean didn't. Sean got the... Sean
he
got
flew.
The, yeah, he planned, yeah. But Jules went on the Gallagate.
Why did you take the bus?
It's an experience, I guess. Cousin
must have done something wrong.
Because until you've seen Mark Coleman sing, I guess that's the way to do it. But we'll guess we'll talk very quickly about the trouble after the game. Have you read some things about that, Pre?
I have. I feel that I am upset.
All right, you want to let us know?
I guess my... summary of it
would be that I think the Dutch, well, first of all, there was an element within the Ajax support that were looking for trouble and made that quite clear the night before when they went to that old sailor pub in the red light district and sort of try to, you know, run through a couple of blokes inside the bar who were having a quiet drink. And that probably would have pissed off an element of our support that were over there for a party and didn't have tickets. Because I think that all those stuff, all the incidents that you saw on the TV and all the papers have written about happened about 6 o'clock, so a couple of hours before the actual kickoff. those guys that were throwing bottles at the police and that kind of stuff, I don't think they were ever going to the game anyway. And I don't think that was a good thing. I think the whole chucking the bottles and stuff is just fucking ridiculous. And from what I'd read, that there were just being complete, you know, dickheads. And a lot of people, it was difficult for the Celtic supporters to try and police themselves because they were also fucking pissed and probably off their fucking trees on bloody, you know, hash cookies and stuff. I don't think Celtic support did themselves any favours with some of those guys behaving the way they did. But I get a sense that it was a pretty edgy kind of experience for the two days being in the city. So, not a great, not something that you'd expect for a Champions League outing. You know, this is meant to be one of the premier sporting competitions, and you know, tourism and is an important component of it. And you know, you want to go to a sporting event and not have to deal with that kind of shit. That's a very 1980s kind of event that happened, I thought, and not something we should be happening in 2013. So, you know, all around, I don't think it was great. But I think the Dutch police are pretty heavy-handed as well. I think they should look themselves and think, well, we kind of fucked that up.
Yeah, I think you're right. Like, I mean, we're like every other Scottish journalist who wrote about it, that we went there, so we don't really know. I spoke to Jules and Sean today about it, and I just asked, you know, their thoughts on what they thought happened. And Jules was actually in the square. Jules was in the square prior to 6 o'clock when it was just about to kick off. And she said, well, they avoided trouble. They left the damn square about half an hour before it all kicked off because we could tell there was going to be trouble. So I think from what I've read on ATIMS, we did a really good synopsis of what happened, and a couple of forums. It seems like a lot of people went over there, not the primary objective to watch Celtic, but you know, because it's Amsterdam and that's what young kids do, which is fair enough. And I think the events leading up to it, which Celtic also issued a statement, you know, talking about the game, more than 300 seats were damaged at Celtic Park, a couple of threat stewards. Then you had, you know, Glasgow City Centre smashed up by a couple of Ajax fans. There was a couple of Twitter pictures of bullet holes in a pub, and someone had supposedly fired bullets at a Celtic fan and a Celtic family, which I think they're investigating now. And there's more reports, which, yeah, this is just typical Scottish media. I know this is nothing new to the people listening to us, but who had taken a picture. There was a video of a Celtic fan getting bitten by a dog, which is similar to a picture got, which was of the big fat Hun getting bitten by a dog in Manchester. And they were saying, you know, this is the type of abuse that Celtic fans were causing, and this is what the police had to do. That guy has now been, he was arrested. He's now in hospital, I think. And he's been given the all clear from the police and given a compensation number because he was unfairly targeted. So the MSM have run this story, you know, all, you know,
comparing it to the Huns.
Yeah, and so, yeah, I think Keith Jackson wrote that was like Manchester. Mm. Well, no, because Manchester was actually a riot, you know.
Yep.
The city was...
They're still repairing it.
The city was smashed up. And I think that, you know, there is a romance to... I think there's a romance that I think we've all bought into with the Celtic support going away on holidays. Like, you know, they never do anything wrong, and a lot of them aren't there just for the drink and for the hookers and for the drugs and stuff, because all that happens on an away trip. But what Celtic fans are very good at is policing themselves, is what you said, Pre. And I think the problem with the amount of... There was 10,000 people that went, you know, to Amsterdam. I think most of those people who didn't have tickets would simply go in there because it was, you know, there was going to be a Celtic game, but, you know, all the other things you can get in Amsterdam. So I think it would have been very difficult for the proper regular Celtic fans to police themselves in certain regards. You know, speaking with Sean as well, Sean didn't have any problems at all, and he was out till 6 in the morning, so... I guess it's really where you go, and it's really where you congregate. But at the end of the day, I think it will be properly investigated. And, you know, just things like fucking... And Tom English, in The Scotsman, said he got it wrong in his article, but he wrote, and the away fans put up a Fenian Bastards banner, which will get investigated by UEFA. It wasn't the Celtic fans, it was the Ajax fans who put up a banner, which are Fenian Bastards. So you got that type of provocation, you know, what do you think is going to happen, you know, after or before the game?
But, I mean, I read the article by Keith Jackson. He's an idiot.
I haven't read it. I haven't actually read it.
And, like, to compare it to Manchester is just a joke. Like, it was millions upon millions of pounds damaged to that city, you know, hundreds of arrests. It was, you know, like, rampaging riots across the city for hours upon hours. And to compare it to what happened in Amsterdam, where I think that they made, like, between 10 and 15 arrests, and most of them weren't for sort of any kind of violence, but just for being completely off their face. A couple of dickheads throwing some bottles, and, you know, a couple of punch-ups in the square, and that's about it. I mean, it's just ridiculous to compare it to Manchester. And, you know, I just wonder some of these people, like these so-called journalists, what drugs they're on, because it's ludicrous to even, you know, try and draw a comparison. But one thing I did find interesting was the police. Like, that guy absolutely laying into that kid, like kicking the shit out of him, dropping the knees into his guts and stuff. Like, everyone knows that everyone was standing. Like, if you look at the footage, there's so many people standing around with their phones, filming everything. And this guy, you know, this guy, this plainclothes police officer, thinks it's a good idea to... I'm suspicious about why the Dutch police had plainclothes police officers. What was that serving?
And not only...
What was the purpose of that?
Not only were they plainclothes, but they look like friggin' ultras. Like, they look exactly like football fans. I don't understand why you do that. I don't get that mentality, because that's going to just cause trouble and trouble. And there was a picture of that guy. There's a picture of a policeman who was kicking the shit out of a young kid, and he got caught. The policeman, you know, the kid was trying to fight back, I think, because he didn't know what this guy was. He was just kicking the shit out of him. And he was, I think, well, from what I can kind of see, the policeman got kind of caught in, like, the tram lines, and a tram was coming.
Yeah.
And he got caught kind of in the tram, and the tram kind of pulled him along, and he hit his head on a telephone pole, got knocked out.
Yeah.
But it was the guy's, you know, that's his provocation, that's just, you know.
Well, apparently that tram driver is also going to be taking a call as well.
It was just, and like, the last thing I would say is the thing that annoys me the most is, and this is the good and bad things about Twitter, I guess, is guys like fucking Graham Spears, who, you know, in terms of Scottish journalism, I don't know if he's the best, but he's probably as close as he's going to get, which doesn't say a lot for that profession.
No.
But he just goes on to Twitter and goads the Celtic fans by going, you know, oh, you guys say it's just as bad as the Huns, and he, you know, Celtic fans inundating me with Twitter messages about, you know, oh, it wasn't our fault and shit like that. Stop goading Celtic fans. You know, write an article about it. Stand by your article, because he didn't. He wrote an article and then quickly backtracked on Twitter, saying, oh, no, you know, saying, firstly, he wasn't there, so you're getting hearsay reports, which is, you know, inadmissible, and a whole bunch of bullshit. So either write something, stand by it, or don't bother in the first place. Don't feel like you have to write something because, you know, a whole bunch of people on one side of the city will crack the shits. It's just that annoys me. Fairness, or like, yeah, having two points of view for the sake of having two points of view doesn't actually make you any more fair or give you any more integrity as a journalist. You should report the facts, and that's what you should report, you know?
I think I don't mind Graham Spears as a writer, but I think he fancies himself a bit too, so that's part of it. He, you know, journalists should be personalities. They shouldn't be a part of the story. And Twitter gives them an opportunity to sort of be like that. And I think he's got a bit of... I think he, you know, he's a bit off himself. Yeah.
But that's bringing in that whole other topic of, you know, now with the 24-hour news service and Twitter and Facebook and all the other mediums, you know, when he writes an article, he must sit there and go, why am I bothering? You know, by the time this gets out, I'll have had conversations for the next 10 hours with, you know, and I might have even changed my view, you know, if I was a reasonably responsible person. So the futility of the journo right now is they're just starting to wake up to how pathetic their job is.
It's more so when it's like things like the Daily Record and the fucking Sun shit, where they have to write a pretty outrageous article to get some traction, and a massive banner page headline. You know, Celtic fans, you know, e.g. the Dundee riots. You know, John Hartson wasn't there, but he somehow knew about 400 people getting arrested.
Mm.
I was there, and that didn't happen. You know, so they have to write these, you know, quite outrageous articles straight away after the game without actually doing any type of journalism, looking into evidence, and then 12 hours later. it'll have turned around, and you'll and through Twitter and through Facebook and through having everyone having access to a camera and or mobile phone, we start to see the proper evidence of what's happening. And the fact that Soddy came out and Neil Lennon's come out and been pretty strong, which we haven't really seen recently from Celtic backing up their fans, is a good sign of what's going to happen.
So what's the plan next couple of days free? You watch the cross-country game?
I head back tomorrow, so...
Straight back, is it? Straight back?
Straight back, yep. So leave on Saturday afternoon and get back Monday lunchtime.
Mm-hmm.
So Sunday will not exist in my life.
What time are you getting back on Monday?
11, I think. Around 11.
Unlucky. I was in the sea on Monday.
I tried to change my flights to see if I could actually stay a couple of days, but they were too expensive, so I'm coming home.
Had a good trip?
I have. It's been a great time. I love Boston. It's a good city. I've had my fill of watching plenty of sport and drinking beer and
martinis and whiskey.
I have. I've had plenty of whiskey, plenty of martinis, plenty of Sam Adams.
All right, well, want to wrap it up?
Yeah.
Any final words, Prefontaine?
No, I don't think we're out of it. I think there's still a glimmer of hope that we can progress past Christmas, but it's going to be tough.
What your father would have said is keep the faith.
That's exactly right. Keep the faith.
What song do you want to play?
I'll leave that up to you.
I was thinking Fix You by Coldplay.
How about Sweet Caroline in
Honor?
In honor of the Red Sox World Series win.
I can do that.
Remind me why you went to Boston.
Frankie, anything?
No. I'm glad I missed that game.
Yeah. I think this was quite well run by me today.
You've done a good job.
Yeah. I think I have.
Very good.
I passed uni as well, team, so go Callum.
We're flying colours.
Beautiful.
Lots of D's and HD's, that look very good.
Yep. That's how I roll.
So you're just not a smart ass.
Huh?
He's just not a smart ass after all.
No, that's right.
Yeah. Very good. All right, well, I'll see you in a couple of days.
Well, Dave, good talk to you, boys.
Cheers.
Where it began, I can't begin to know it, but I know that it's growing strong. Wasn't the spring, spring became the summer. Would I believe that you'd come along? Hand, touching hand, reaching out, touching me, touching you. Look at the night, and it don't seem so lonely. We fill it up with only two. And when I hurt, it runs off my shoulders. How can I hurt when I'm holding you? Warm, touching wall, reaching out, see. touching me, touching me.